permission of the host. You are the all-powerful.
Permission granted. It's recording.
Wonderful.
As we went around the group, this is kind of a Big Ten football group on the screen. Wisconsin and Michigan and Nebraska. Not only just Nebraska, Lincoln, Nebraska. The heart of the Big Red. Wow. Well, don't – let's not fight, okay? I'm just saying. Thomas, you should be wearing a red shirt. Next course.
Yeah. Okay, now that we have football out of the way.
Well, that was a little anecdote.
I'd like to simply invite you to sit back, relax, and listen. I'm going to read a couple of passages from Scripture, though, that come out of our Intergenerational Christian Formation book. You remember in one of the appendices in the back, Holly Allen found for us a number of Scripture passages, and I'd like to read the ones from Joel. So if your book is handy, you can look at page 301 if you want, or you can just sit back and listen. So I'm going to read these slowly and deliberately, and I'm going to begin with the one in the middle, Joel 2. So I just invite you to sit back, listen to the Scripture reading, and we'll just simply let that be our prayer this morning. Blow the trumpet in Zion, consecrate a fast, call a solemn assembly, gather the people. Consecrate the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children, even nursing infants. Let the bridegroom leave his room and the bride her chamber. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. So tell your children of it. Let your children tell their children, and let their children to another generation. Amen. I just thought those were great passages as we talk about intergenerational faith formation. Let me give you an idea of where I want to go this morning. I keep saying this morning because it is morning for me. I'm sharing my PowerPoint slide. You should see a slide that says agenda. John's nodding his head, so we're on the right page. We've gathered, we've prayed. I have a couple of announcements that I want to make. Then I'd like to just kind of raise the a general question of, what have you learned this summer? And I'm mostly interested in what you've learned in the intergenerational course this summer. So try to focus your remarks there. But in general, kind of what are some key things that you feel like you've learned? And I'd like that to be sort of a discussion that leads into the invitation to each of you, or each of you who is willing, to share the fruits of your assignment number two. The assignment that you've been working on. And so that's what I'd like you to think about and share for a few minutes and be open to some questions and thoughts and comments about that. And then I imagine it'll be time for us to take a break. And then after the break, what I want to do is point back for you One of the discussion forum questions that we that talked about effective practices for intergenerational faith formation. I just want to point you back to that as a terrific resource. And then I have some more slides to share right here, but at the end of our session, I'd like to kind of conclude with the question of, all right, what makes an intergenerational experience really sing? And I have some 10 or 12 points that I have picked up over the years from practitioners, but I'm curious to hear what you would add to that as well. So that's the general direction that I want to go this morning. Sound okay? All right. First of all, some announcements. Let me take you to what I have on the screen is the orientation page for course number 3. And my announcements start there. Just to let you know that course number 3 begins on September 12th. By the way, this orientation page, I don't know if you can see the URL up here. If you can, you can make a copy of that. I will also include a link to it later today in an email to you that follows up our session, so don't worry. But this is a really helpful page that particularly because it gives the important dates for your upcoming course. The upcoming course is on family faith formation. Next week, well, right here it says September 7th, that you'll receive the invite to join the course on course sites. I just need you to know that September 7th might be the 8th or the 9th, so don't panic if it comes later than that. But most importantly, notice the course starts on the 12th, but the very first online live session is the 14th. So your first live session is in week 1. And so make note of that, that's on the calendar at the same hour, 1 to 4 p.m. Eastern. Okay. The other announcements that I have for you are with respect to the course that you're currently in. When I finish grading your assignment number 2, and I've only done a couple of them, and I apologize for that, but they will be done soon. I believe course sites send you a notice that your assignment has been graded, and it should also send you some kind of indication of your digital badge that you receive for having completed the course. But if for some reason that doesn't come through in an automated fashion, please let me know. Also, announcement is this. Course number 2 that you've been in will remain available to you until about the 1st of November. After that, it will disappear from your screen, or when you log into course sites and you click on the button that says My Course Sites, you're going to wonder, oh, where did that course go? And it hasn't disappeared. It hasn't been deleted. It's just gone offline. And Mary can attest to you that we can put it back online for a short amount of time if you want that. All you have to do is let me know. Mary had a desire to go back and see some of the things that she was working on in course 1, so I made that available to her, but that will again disappear next week. All right, so those are the announcements. So let's move into a broad brush, kind of general discussion. I invite you to unmute your microphone and simply chime in. What have you learned from the intergenerational course? In general, I guess is what I'm saying, or an insight that you hadn't thought of, or something that the rest of us could benefit from.
Well, I can begin, if that's okay.
Yeah, Mary.
Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know if any, I'm sure we all read the same information, but that breakdown you had of the, in one of the books, I think it was, about the different generations, who their heroes were, what happened in their time frame, that was extremely helpful for me. And I used that in a small group discussion with some of our older members, and it was enlightening to them as well. And I think further discussion would be really helpful for them to understand a little bit better about those younger generations, why they are different than the builders, you know. So that was very helpful for me.
You know, I want to echo that too. And John, I don't know if you want to chime in on that, because I know you developed that material, or at least curated it. But I too found it really, really helpful to understand the identity of particular generations in our current realm of history, and how they have particular personalities, I guess, and tendencies. So it isn't just the oldsters, and they aren't that way just because they're old, but they're also that way because they're the builder generation, and the experience that they had in history is different than say the millennial generation. They aren't that way just because they're young, but they are that way because they're young and occupy their role in our culture and society at the time. Yeah, that was really helpful to me too. Somebody else.
Well, this is Judy. We do a lot of intergenerational things, but my new word I've learned out of this course is intentional. I'm not intentional enough about it. So we put these programs together and we hope that all generations come and we get some generations, but not all of them. So I need to start, whenever we do things, to go after the different groups that don't show up in a more deliberate way. And then I think we need to be more deliberate about setting the stage and letting them know what's going to happen and why it's important we all show up at the table. And then maybe at the end, kind of talk to some people who normally don't come and say, thanks for coming, and your presence was great, and it really added a lot. But that takes a lot of planning and follow-up when we're running to the next program that's the next day, and we don't have time yet to get it done. So it's something I realize I need to surround our activities with.
What particular generations are more reluctant to show up than others in your setting?
Well, in a lot of our activities, people think are family. So if you don't have a child, they're not going to come. And mm-hmm. So I'm missing out on the empty nesters. Once their kids go to college, they're like, oh, we're done. It's no, you're not, but you might think you are. I'm missing out on the older generation. And unfortunately, we don't have a lot of young adults in Fairfax. You can't afford, unless you're living with your parents, to live here. So they tend to be further into the city in apartments with their friends, having a blast, but they're not around us. But there are a couple that are living at home and they don't come either. So I'm trying to figure out how in whatever the activity is to bring those three missing pieces so that we have families with older people, older youth that could share experiences with the younger youth, the empty nesters and the older people who are now grandparent stage, but maybe don't live near their kids, need to understand, mm-hmm. We need you to come and be grandparents. We need you to be part of this. Well, I like the faith circle analogy that was used in one of the videos. I need you to surround these kids so this does not me, the pastor, and the Sunday school teacher. There needs to be someone that's helping us surround these children. But we're not, there yet.
Yeah. All right. Thank you, Judy. Somebody else?
Yeah, I can maybe share a little bit. One thing I'm really excited about was actually the resource you just started with, Lee, with the biblical appendix. I really appreciate that out of this book, because it draws these biblical underlining foundation out and makes it easier to translate that what we're doing here is not something exotic. That's really something foundational. It's biblical, and people are willing to engage with that. I think the Bible still carries some authority in that sense. I found it extremely helpful, this collection, and we will include some of that in our programming with a devotion time each time. Yeah.
Great. Yeah. Good. Anybody else want to just share a general learning? Perhaps you saw Denise's chat. She writes, family doesn't supplement learning from church. The church supplements what happens in the family. That's good. That's very helpful.
That's very true to what we've been learning, but it's not the way it seems like the church and families have been functioning, at least not in our church. It's been very church-driven, and there might be a trickling of things that happen at home, so I don't like to change that paradigm.
Well, that will certainly be a focus of your next course on family faith formation, yes. But I'm also curious to hear about as we talk through today, and as you share some of your ideas and plans centered around your assignment number two, I'm curious about getting over the challenge. I think that Judy mentioned is sometimes we use the word intergenerational, and in the minds of even ourselves, but certainly parishioners. Oh, that implies parents and their children. And if I'm not actively parenting, that doesn't apply to me. And yet we want it to, and we recognize that it needs to. And so how do we communicate that intergenerational means all ages and stages and do that effectively? So
Leif, I like that comment. The other issue is when you talk about family ministry, the minute you say family, they definitely assume it's parents and children.
Yeah.
And we've been struggling with what do you say, church family, whatever. So I would love a term that works and people understood that was bigger than family, because to us, family is whatever you're whoever lives in your room, in your house or apartment, you know, whoever dwells in your building is your family. And so now come be dwellers. We could do dweller ministry. Dweller in your house is your family, because it gets in the way all the time.
Yeah.
And then I don't even try to use intergenerational out loud, because then that just, they don't even understand what that is.
Yeah. Yeah. You're probably right.
So it's hard just to language what we're trying to do without putting like a whole paragraph, and then they don't read it anyway. Mm-hmm. So. Mm-hmm.
Judy, put pictures to it.
Okay.
In other words, if you say family, put a dozen pictures. So every time you say family, point to the poster, point to the website, point to whatever it is you're using, but point to, when we say family, we mean this. And just get the diversity, the ages, empty nesters to multi-generational, to families with peewees, I mean, the married couples. Just do the whole scope. And because family has been redefined and people are seeing the broader, because they're naming it more broadly. I think visually they have to see it.
Okay, that's a great idea.
You know, and get a lot of grandparents with grandkids so that they see that. And then when you say, we're an all ages or all generations church, they can see it. You know, a church for all generations. And that way you can say intergenerational without having to explain intergenerational. You simply say all generations. And I think the visuals communicate better today than the words do. And I grew up in a word-based culture, but images capture it better today. So I've watched churches use visuals to really communicate that.
Okay.
We're gonna watch it. We're gonna watch a video in the family course about the family today, and it just is vignettes of families across the whole spectrum. And that does more to change mindsets because they see it as, oh yeah, I know somebody like that. I know somebody there. I know somebody there. That's what you want to happen.
Okay, thanks.
See how that works. You know, we're in the period of we're just trying to experiment with ways to communicate it, but we know words are not enough.
Right.
Yeah, sometimes the words get in the way, just as you said, Judy. So yeah, John, that makes sense. Thank you.
A friend of mine and Leaves as well, Linda Stocks, who's done a lot of work in intergenerational and milestones and the rest. She was telling me a story a couple of weeks ago that she facilitated an all ages gathering at a church in town. She was asked to be the guest speaker, presenter, facilitator for an experience. And she had people from 2 or 3 years old to 103. And I just thought, she said, it's the first time in all her years she's ever done a 10-decade program with all 10 decades present. And I thought, all I got to do is take get a group picture of all of them and say, this is it. This is our church. I think that would communicate. But she was stunned. She's been at it for, you know, 40-something years. First time she ever had 10 decades president at Common Core. So the 103-year-old was quite with it.
Great. Heather, Kathy, I don't want to put you on the spot, but I don't want to leave you out.
No, I was just waiting. So I think I echo what Judy was saying about intentional, and that's a word that I've thrown around a lot over the last several years, but to make it part of the paradigm, the culture, the expectation of intentional, whatever it is, whatever kind of faith formation or worship or networking or mission, whatever it is, to make sure that it's intentional. But I really appreciated too the generations and helping to understand the differences in generations. The pastor that I'm working with is in a different generation from me. And so it really helped to start clarify some of the things that were important to him. And I go, why in the world is that so important to you? And that started to help make sense. But if I can understand that about him and about other generations, then it puts me in a place where I can reach people better where they are. And then bridging gaps becomes a little bit easier because I know some of the language that's going to help to reach each one of those generations.
That's great.
Yeah, that's good. Thank you.
Yeah, and then just kind of to echo what both Kathy and Judy said, I just really have been struggling with that word intentional and how to incorporate that and make things like, yeah, we're, you know, when I brought things to my pastor's attention, it was, well, we are intergenerational because, but we're really not, because they were intergenerational by default and not intentionally putting ourselves there. So I've really appreciated just, I guess, the literature to back up what I've been trying to say since I started. and then examples of what other churches and just kind of feeding off of everybody else, of what other people are doing in worship and how to really make that intergenerational happen.
Thank you, Heather. Thank you. John, I wonder if I could put you on the spot for a moment. And could you Could you describe the difference between intergenerational programming and intergenerationality in the community? I think that's part of what we're getting at here.
Yeah. It's we all know intergenerational programs. You get a couple enough generations under the same tent and you do something with them. But intergenerationality is more cultural. So, you know, it's the subtle things you do. It's at Sunday worship, getting people to connect with each other. It's the refreshments after, you know, Sunday worship where you mix people. Maybe it's the question of the week. Maybe it's placemats where they sit. You know, but it's just this weave that you take through what you do, so that what people bounce up against is they don't experience church as an age phenomena. They experience church as a community phenomena. So whether it's worship or learning, leadership. So when you look at councils and leadership groups, does it reflect multiple generations? That's intergenerationality for me. And when it becomes cultural, meaning it's just the fabric of what we do, then you worry less and less about the program side. I mean, you start doing programs that are intergenerational because everything we do as church is intergenerational. We discovered, I mean, this whole concept, I mean, Holly Allen in her book, she's very strong on that because she discovered that in her research and in her work. But when I work with Raleigh Martinson and Wes Black on the Exemplar Youth Ministry book and study, we uncovered the sense of intergenerational culture by studying youth ministry. You know, how are these kids growing in mature Christian faith and families growing in mature Christian faith? What are these congregations doing? And it was not programmatic. I mean, the list of youth ministry activities was pretty much what anybody would expect. There wasn't an aha in the whole list. But the aha was what the culture of the church did, is it just integrated all the generations. Everybody was worthwhile. Everyone had a gift to share. And that was communicated from the pulpit, at worship, in learning, at social, and mission. And teenagers would say, everybody knows me here. And I'm not talking about a small church of 15 people. I'm talking about big churches. Everybody knows me here. That's really kind of remarkable. So when I think about intergenerationality, I think of it as cultural, and that programs and activities happen, but relationships sustain it, ministries sustain it, and you grow into that. We asked the story of churches, well, tell me when you became intergenerational, and they would look at us and go, well, I don't know. I think we started out that way. So I mean, that's when you do that, that's the cultural piece. It's not a moment. This is the way we do things here. As you start, that's why I love the word intentionally intergenerational. Once you start down that road, all those intentional acts that you engage in to become more intergenerational, the infusing of it into your life, the product of that is really an intergenerational culture, not a set of intergenerational programs. It's really the culture is intergenerational. And then you could step back and let the culture work. Leif and I have both been involved in intergenerational learning projects with churches and all the struggles of moving from Sunday school to intergenerational. But after 5 or 6 years, it's all people know. And that's when you move from program to culture.
To piggyback on that, I want to share with all of you a little piece from Carrie Sullivan's assignment. I hope she doesn't mind, but she talks about moving toward this culture in this way. Carrie is one of your classmates, and she can't be with us today, but she talks about an experience. I don't know if you can read what's on the screen, but I'll just read it out loud. I went up to do announcements that Sunday with the youngest member of our church family. We are a church of about 200 on a Sunday morning. I asked, if you are 60 to 100 years old, raise your hands if you can tell me the name of this child. One person raised their hand. If you are 40 to 59, one person raised their hand. If you are 20 to 39, seven people raised their hand. If you are 0 to 19, years old, one person raised their hand. Church, this is Silas Newton. You didn't know him by sight. How many of you have prayed for him? Her whole focus in her assignment is moving toward an intergenerational prayer chain, if you will, that encompasses the whole congregation. How many of you brought a meal to this family? Can you name his siblings, his parents? Wouldn't it be amazing if in 18 years, when Silas is standing on this stage in his cap and gown, I just lost my screen. Sorry. In his cap and gown, if there were at least 18 people that know him, I mean really know him and love him and are for him, then I got choked up. Don't we want to be known by members of our church family? And then she explained the Pray For Me campaign and how it all works. Huge response. Sign-ups until the end of this month. And then they're making matches. So I just thought I liked... I'm not sure that the Pray For Me campaign would work in the church that I'm working in, but I liked this notion of Carrie demonstrating to the community this sense of relationships across the generations. So I like that, but I don't...
That's a great story.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, next stop is an invitation to someone to go first, to simply share what it is you're up to, more from a, dare I say, programming mode. Mary's raising her hand.
Yes, I will. Yes. Because I'm sure many more are more detailed and more exciting, but...
And by the way, if any of you want to share something on screen, a document for us to look at, there is a button on your screen that says share screen, and then it will give you the options. But don't feel obligated. So, Mary, go ahead.
I just want to start first. John just gave me a great addition to our brand new mission statement. To the very beginning is encouraging faith, and I'd like to suggest to our team to include encouraging faith in all generations and proclaiming God's love, because that's so key, and I just love that. But anyways, first I just want to say, just being intentional about talking about doing faith formation and building relationships between the generations is brand new for our congregation. We just hadn't thought much about being intentional about it, so this is a big leap forward. Most of our programming happens age-related groups, so this is really exciting for me. And just having this process of thinking through how to create and promote and follow up on these programs has just been invaluable, because the process makes it so much simpler to talk through and then to get people surrounding it and buying into it and participating in it. And so that's been very helpful to me. I just have three program or project ideas. And the first is one we've read about a lot in our texts, and that's just doing an intergenerational faith formation event with our Sunday school classes, bringing all of the class groups together. And we have children as young as 3, and I always say 3 to 103, but no one's 103 anymore in our congregation. But the main idea is just to bring us together in open lines of communication and to learn together and to build those relationships. So we're going to do that this year. We have scheduled one event for sure this coming season, and that's going to be November 27th. Which is the Sunday of the Thanksgiving weekend. And we've been able to tie it into our schedule so we can bring all the classes together. The youngest kids will just be finishing up 3 weeks of studying the nativity story through the beginner Bibles curriculum. And the older kids are all going to be starting the next week getting ready for the Christmas program. So it's a familiar story for everyone of all ages. So we're going to bring that together and do many of the things that we read about, praying together, having young people read the story, being in small group settings, multiple age groups, talking about it, doing some kind of activity, breaking out to age-related group discussion, and then coming back together. So I'm just excited we're doing that, that we have a plan in action. Where we're a little weak right now is the training portion. I'd like to include that in the future so that our teachers that are participating have an idea what it's like to work with people of many generations. And then we really need to implement something for the feedback, because that's the only way we're going to know if we're being successful or not, is if there's a way for us to get feedback from the participants to see what how they like that. And then the plan would then go to a larger launch during the end of Lent, or you know, maybe like the Palm Sunday or the Saturday before Palm Sunday, hopefully getting more people involved with that. The second one is bringing parents and grandparents into the three-year-old through kindergarten class, and to encourage and empower parents and grandparents to be faith formers. And so we are doing that once this first semester. And again, we're using our beginner Bible curriculum, and we're going to have them come in. We're going to use the same schedule we do every Sunday, so the children feel really confident about what we're doing. But we're going to be doing some work ahead of time to prepare our parents and grandparents about, here's the story so you can familiarize yourself. Here are the songs we're going to be singing so you can maybe sing along. Most of that's going to be online too, and online, using online access is really brand new to our congregation too, as far as giving information and resources to people. And then we'll have that class time together, and then mostly online again, following up the next week with, all right, parents, here's the next story. Here's the story. Here are our songs, and then allowing them to use that information to keep the conversation and learning happening at home. So again, training is important, making things happen online, getting them online for our families, making it available to them, getting to them to actually use it might be interesting, and then follow up on that. So excited about that. And the third one's a little bit different, and maybe this is the intergenerationality you were talking about. We have a service project every month. We have a food distribution. We get hundreds of people that come into our church and they purchase a share of food. And it is already intergenerational. It's been going on for 4 years now. We have people from all denominations, all different service projects, the schools, and they are helping out 40 to 60 or more people. But we don't really know each other very well. And so two of the things that I'm promoting is something as simple as name tags. So only about 20% of us have a name tag with our actual name on it. Everyone else just says volunteer. Some of the organizers thought it's going to be too costly to have special name tags for everyone. And we're just talking about a plastic thing with a clip, right? Oh my goodness, that's too expensive. We can't have one for everyone. So just getting everyone to have a name tag, because they even joke about, hey, I'm volunteer, you know. So and then trying to find ways to get them to know one another. A combination of things like picture boards, or is there a question of the week? Because what happens is most of us are in the basement, and the building, the room is set up in a U shape, and the guests come and we put their baskets in wagons, and then we bring their wagons around, trying interacting with the guests as they go around the room and they collect their food. And then they go outside and other volunteers put everything into their cars. So if you're a wagon puller, you're constantly interacting with people along the room, whether they're guests or they're volunteers. So is there a way we could have a question of the night or a series of questions that we could kind of say, you know, have you ever been on the mountain or something? I don't know. We're trying to work that all out.
Yeah, I like
it. Yeah. I like so, The thing is, I haven't got a chance to talk to the committee that runs the food distribution, and so I haven't got total buy-in to how we want to do this. But like I said, we've been doing this 4 or 5 years, and many of these are regulars, and they just they don't even know first names. So I think it's important for us in a small community to improve that relationship building. So that one's a little sketchy. Not sure of all the details on that one. And that's pretty much all I have. It's just for us to be thinking about how to strategize and how to plan, how to create a timeline so we can be on top of that and we can be accountable to that, to be able to evaluate and decide when we're going to stay small scale or build to something bigger, and then really how to use our online resources. We have a Facebook page, which we're getting more business on or more traffic on because we're using it more often, and to improve our online website. So those are, like I say, it's a huge transition for us. Our congregation is going through a big restructuring right now. So that's been taking a lot of our time, our leadership's time, mine especially. But that's all good because we're identifying who we are. And we are being able to rebrand ourselves and get our name better known in the community as well. So.
Mary, thank you. A couple of questions, if you don't mind. You talked, your second programming idea about connecting parents and grandparents to the three-year-old group.
Right.
And I didn't quite follow what your thoughts about the online component for that.
Oh, sure. Yeah. So on the online, we would want to promote the story of the whatever story we're going to be presenting, so the parents are familiar with the story. That might be as simple as a video, or maybe it's just an email too, saying this is a story. You can find it on this page in your child's beginner Bible. This is the song the children are going to be singing because our little kids sing once a month. And so they have to practice for weeks to get that song down. So maybe the parents could learn that song. So we'd have a video of that song and they could learn that, sing along with their children. And then suppose kind of questions, how to be in discussion about it too. And I'm really hoping to find, and I'm sure you guys have great resources, just more videos or words or ways to explain to parents, how are you faith formers? You know, what is your role in that? How can you do that in home or wherever you're at with your children and not limit faith formation to that hour in Sunday school?
Right, right. Yeah. Good. Yeah, I think that makes sense. I like the way you describe the online digital component as a support to the process. The other question that I had, backing up to your first programming idea, your plan for November 27th, sounds like an intergenerational learning experience that launches the whole community well into Advent and the Christmas season, right?
Right, because that's the first day of Advent, too.
Yeah, right, right. Have you, I kind of forget what my question was, but it was an important one. I'm curious, you described an experience, and I presume it's going to take place after Sunday worship that day, or is it part of Sunday worship?
It'll be during Sunday school, which is before worship.
Oh, I see. Okay. Yep. So during the Sunday school hour, which always happens before worship,
right.
This is what's going on.
Right.
Is that will that be an all new experience for people to just drop their kids off, but to hang around?
Well, it's going to be new too to bring the different age groups together. We sometimes might bring some of the first and third graders into the younger class and, you know, that kind of thing. But we're bringing the adults into the conversation too. In fact, I was just having a conversation with the person leading our middle school class. And this middle school class and our adults are doing a study on honoring our neighbor's faith. And our first discussion is me about Lutheranism and the Reformation. And we were watching this video from Reform. I don't know if you've ever heard of Reform, but it's funny. It's very cartoony. It's very middle schoolish. And he said, I think we should bring the adults in this conversation. They should watch us too. And I said, won't that be a little silly for him? And he said, no, that'd be great. So this is, I'm really curious to see how that's going to work out, because I'm not sure how the adults are going to respond to that. It's very simple and it's easy to understand, but it is kind of like middle school humor too. So, so that's kind of, that'll maybe start to build on that idea of coming together and not being just age related groups on Sundays.
Something to think about.
Yes.
Is what would that experience bring into worship on that very day?
Oh, yeah.
In other words, is there some visual or piece of music or something that they do during Sunday school hour that marches right into worship that day and is kind of a witness or testament to everyone else who comes for worship that day?
I love that idea. Oh, that's great. So bring that into the worship. Okay. That's a great idea.
And then just lastly.
Yes.
I don't mean to grill you because okay. I'm fearful that everybody else is going to get worried that I'm going to pump them full of questions too. But you ended your description of that by saying something about looking ahead to late Lent. Does that mean you want to kind of do a similar program then?
Right. And I'm not sure then if we want to expand that to maybe the day before Advent, Palm Sunday, work a larger event on a Saturday, have more time, or if we want to do something again during Sunday school hour. And then, as you say, you know, bring that into the worship service would be another opportunity. Yeah. I'm not sure. I have to check our schedule. Our schools have a spring break, and I can't remember if it's around Palm Sunday or if it's around Easter. So that would make a difference in how we would plan that.
Oh, Mary, thank you.
Sure.
You have done great work here. I'm anxious to actually read your assignment. So.
Okay.
Questions or comments from the rest of you to Mary? Any thoughts or suggestions for her? All right, then. Somebody want to go next?
I'll go next if anyone else wants to.
Great.
Okay. I have a visual. I didn't do a slide, but I did this little, can you see this little pink thing? Nope.
Yeah, I can see it.
That was my notes. I'm a big post-it person. So that was a big post-it. We're doing a couple things, and I have a visual for that too. We're doing, for the Lutherans out there, we'll know God's hands, our work, God's hands, Sunday.
Yep.
Our rally day now is a huge service project on-site and off-site. So the majority of the congregation after worship joins us for lunch, and then we go out and do service projects. So we've done this for a couple of years, but we haven't, I'm being more intentional this year. So we have t-shirts, so we'll have lots of big people running around doing service projects. We get a lot of stuff from Thrivent for free. And there'll be service projects where there'll be yard work and building a house, working on a house off-site in Vienna, and blankets to make for kids and all different things. And then we'll have little kids involved too. See little cute t-shirts? Little kids involved too. So almost every one of the service projects can have multi-generational ages together. We do Stop Hunger Now, which some of you might do. We make those 10,000 meals in a morning. The little kids take the finished pack meals and they put it in a bucket and they take the bucket over to where they package them. So they can't do the measuring and they can't do the sealing, but we allow them to hand deliver the finished package to the Packers, which they just love to do. So we try to have some projects that are totally intergenerational. And we also have designed a program, a project that is new for us. It's going out to a nursing home where we'll take a service project out there with some families, and they'll let the service, the people at the nursing home, do the service project. We did this during Vacation Bible School, and it worked out really cute. And they loved that they could be they could serve, because they can't leave the building too often. So they could serve because we bring the project to them. So it's an intergenerational project with different generations working on it. They'll be packing little backpacks for school with school supplies. So we go play bingo with them and give them candy, and then they do a service project. So those are two things that, two ways we're trying to turn Rally Day more intentionally intergenerational. And it is in the service. So the whole service is around Rally Day. Yeah. We dedicate the whole congregation. And then at the end, if they can only stay for 5 minutes, we'll have a project they could do for 5 minutes, a really short little one. And if they can't come that day or they can't stay at all, we have other long-term projects that we try to educate them on so they can sign up to serve on those things later on. So it's a fun day. But and the first time we did it, the older people kept saying, why are there children here touching this stuff? So we're trying to help them understand, because children can serve too. And so we're being a little bit more intentional this year of doing that. So that's our rally day. And the other thing that's infusing is, we had a youth director for a little bit, and she just went off to seminary, which is yay, except now I don't have a youth director. Yay. Mm-hmm. So I'm rebuilding the youth leadership team, trying to get the youth to step up, somebody from each grade to be a leader, and get older adults and parents involved. So before, Sarah, our youth director, did a lot and only asked for help when she needed it. Now I need the team to come back together to work and form a team that can kind of do things when I'm not around or do things when I'm not there to direct them. So we're excited about that. The other things.
Are you saying with as you rebuild the youth leadership team, it's an opportunity to involve parents and others to make it more intergenerational, the team itself? Is that the point here?
Yes. Yeah, and that they're involved in the planning of it. So there's more than just a youth director and youth planning it. The youth help plan it. The parents help plan it. The older people that want to be involved help plan it.
Yeah.
And there was somewhere that I think came out of this course earlier on that said more and more churches are realizing maybe you just don't hire a youth director. You get everyone involved. Mm-hmm. And so we're not replacing our youth director, at least not this year. Probably not next year either, for financial reasons. But I'm not telling people that. I'm mentioning to them that we as a community need to lift up and work with the youth and let the youth take a leadership role and with your guidance and mentorship. That's kind of where we're going.
Yeah.
To see how that works. So the other thing is I have a young adult as my social media intern, which gives me two things. It gives me somebody who starts to have other voices than mine on our social media. And she's in college, and she's already away at college, so we're doing this long distance, but doesn't really matter anymore. So she's going to start with doing a blog on my young adult page of the new Faith Formation website we created. And then if she has time, she's going to continually look at things we're doing on our social media and give me like suggestions or whispers in my ear going, Judy, that's not good. Get that off there. Or that's good. It speaks to people. So my goal, I start with her, is I'd like to get somebody to do a blog on the adult page, the youth page, and the family page, and the special need page. But right now I'm starting with her, and she's willing. We also are going to start something on our webpage called Voices once a month to have a story from different generations and different people that is posted with pictures. I like your idea of pictures. With pictures to help people understand what's going on at King of Kings. And so she's going to help do that because she's also working on her degree in communications, digital communications and blogging and whatever else you do nowadays. So that's something we're doing. Then we're doing... Go ahead.
How did you find this person? How did you get it? How did you set up an internship?
Well, the internship has no money, and it's me and her working together, but we're calling it an internship so she can put it on her resume.
Yeah,
but she's a youth that I know very well that grew up in our program. And she, I have a relationship with her. I'm probably one of her faith circle people. And this summer when I found out what she was majoring in, we just started talking. And she does a blog for some other business. And I said, ooh, would you blog for the church? And would you be willing to help me get other voices out there so that it's not just the staff putting things on Facebook and Twitter and what's the other ones? Snapchat or things that we're trying to use. And so she's helping me do all that.
Okay, that's an idea I'd like to steal. So thank you for that.
Go right ahead. The problem becomes, as with any volunteer, she has yet to do this yet. She's promised me she just got down to school, she put her first blog on. So she only went back 3 days ago. So I guess I'll give her 5 days and then I'll send her a little text and say, hey, I don't see your blog yet.
Yeah. She has nothing
college, to do.
Right. Okay.
Now the next one is something I got from one of the other people in this group, the whole prayer partner. Mm-hmm. Idea. Similar to what, and I'm going to forget names, wait a minute, Mary? Similar to what Mary was just talking about, we want, or the one you read from, we want to start having prayer partners, but we're going to approach a little bit differently. We're just going to pick a couple points of things happening and introduce it. We give out Bibles to third graders. So when we do that this year, there will be a prayer partner with that child writing a note in their Bible. And we'll ask them to pray for that child for a year. We're going to start having prayer partners for confirmation small groups so that every small group is prayed for the next year while they're in confirmation. And so I'll be working with the prayer team first. And then if I don't get enough volunteers that way, I'll go out to the congregation. I'll probably still go out to the congregation and explain what we're getting and ask people to come in and just start praying for specific people. We won't do it across the board. Because we're doing too much other stuff across the board. We're just going to start doing it in small groups and let it grow over time. And eventually the idea would be all our children and youth would have a prayer partner for them as they move forward.
Yeah, I like that a lot. If you're interested, I could put you in touch with Pastor John Mappa at American Lutheran Church in Gothenburg, Nebraska, because they do a prayer partner thing on a seasonal basis, Advent and Lent, and but they've done that in such a way that it isn't just adults for children, but it really is mutual. And it's kind of started off the way you describe it, but they've matured in that process nicely so that everybody gets a prayer partner during those two seasons.
That's a neat idea. I would like to see what he does because I could steal ideas and maybe get further along. Right now we're hoping just to find enough to get our kids that get Bibles prayer partners this year and our confirmation team. And then we'll But I like that you could do that for a season. And we're doing the Jesse tree during Advent this year across the board to all generations. And we might be able to do something like that, tie into that for just Advent. That you, people that are coming together to make Jesse trees and learn about that, that they could pray for each other as they're going through Advent.
Mm-hmm.
So mm-hmm. I'd like to see what he did. And then the last thing is... It's a rollover from both Rally Day and Vacation Bible School. We have started the intergenerational service project every month with Sunrise Assisted Living. And so we're really going to try every month for families to go out to Sunrise and do a service project with them ongoing, not just rally day and then leave them alone. And they're very excited about that. And they're very flexible. So like, we're actually going to go out on rally day. She said, yeah, you can come out on a Sunday. And the other thing she says is, yeah, you can pray. Just do whatever you want to do. It's like, oh, okay, thanks. So we're excited that that ministry is beginning here. So that's great. What we're doing. So I covered everything in my little thing. You saw,
yes,
my
you teacher. Did. I'm impressed. I like that. I like your teaching style. Just one question. One of the things that I learned from John and some colleagues of mine from years back is that whenever we do service, we also want to do service learning, and we want to do service reflection. Kind of do some learning perhaps in advance and some reflection after the experience. What could you build in around that?
Well, we do it when we do rally day. We do it a little bit because the whole worship service is about service, is about why we serve and what it means. And service has been one of King of Kings. It's in our DNA. It's what we do.
Okay.
Our 4th through 6th graders during Vacation Bible School go off site and do service projects most of the week. So they get some of the theme of VBS, but they go off site and do things. Reflection part, we're probably not as good at, as because you have to be really intentional and deliberate to wrap it up and learn. But some of the projects it works really well with, and some it doesn't.
Mm-hmm.
But I know we need to be more deliberate on that.
Judy, thank you. Anybody else have comments, questions for Judy?
Well, Judy, I was wondering if you're familiar with Cherish My Children. It's a weekly, I think it's a weekly email that comes out on Wednesdays, or maybe it's a monthly email. And it's a way to integrate prayer for one another, especially for our children.
Nice.
Yeah.
I will check that out.
Okay.
Yeah, I think with the prayer partner thing, I love the idea of having children pray for other people. And I could see where you have to help them understand what prayer is and teach them to pray a little bit, which we start to do in Sunday school and confirmation. But we plan on follow up by any means with a prayer partner.
Well, Judy, thank you. Thank you very much. Hey, I see that Carrie has joined us. Hey, Carrie, how are you? Welcome. Good. Just so you know, Carrie, we're kind of going one at a time. People are sharing a little bit about their plans that they've written up in assignment number 2. I guess I should admit to you that I shared one paragraph from your assignment with the rest of the group before you joined us. The little story about Wilton. So anyway, just I hope you don't mind. Let's keep going. Let's take at least one more before we take a break. Somebody else want to chime in?
I would love to
share. Did I hear Thomas?
Yes, I would love to. All right. I am, we're 10 days out from launching. So this is a very, very exciting time, also very stressful time. Well, start September 11, what at some point was planned to be Rally Day, to be the first Gift Sunday. And we used that idea that we heard in webinar 2 about, and we heard 2 forms at the last webinar. One was a learning experience form, and the other one was the worship form. And we're going to do both. in some way. Mm-hmm. So a while back, it dates back the planning stages last fall. We took an idea home from a one-day Vibrant Faith seminar, and that was spread through our Faith Formation Committee, and it has grown to that we want to plan a year of intergenerational learning events. And so we are at the point now that we want to do that every second Sunday each month from September to April, 8 months long. And we came up with a 6-year topical plan, and we will start with the year of service and justice this September 11. And within that year, picked a whole range of topics. And the exciting thing that happened somewhere along the way is that our senior pastor jumped on board and said, "This is great. Let's not just do it as an add-on to one more program. Let's that make that a heart of the whole year planning." And so the gift theme each month will basically set the tone of the adult Sunday school, the children's Sunday school going on that month, and even more, it will go into the topics that will be preached on for the whole month. So the gift Sundays will become really the heartbeat of our year.
Yeah.
The other thing that what happened was that our senior pastor said, "Well, let's be really intentional about that. That no one will have an excuse not to come to the gift Sunday, and let's all worship together on that Sunday. We usually have two Sundays, but on gift Sunday we will have just one Sunday at worship, and 9 o'clock, and that's a traditional time slot, but let's make that a blended form of worship with all ages worship, and then the intergenerational learning program that concludes in a meal." So we are here now. We have the brochures sent out. We developed a gift logo with t-shirts.
Yeah. Nice.
We had that.
How do you get one of those shirts?
Yeah,
well, how could a guy get one of those?
I have your address, right? the logo I just ordered on Fiverr for like had a designer there for like $10 or $15 developed. Yeah. And we used that for our brochure as well. We were very intentional about the brochure, not to have it look too what should I say? Program for children, like,
yeah.
We have on our committee one younger single adult who said, "I want to have this look like a program. I would come if it's a children's program. I won't come." And so it looks fairly classical. I think the pictures are like the hands on here. You can see that a little bit.
Yeah.
The threads down here, but they are not the first pictures I put in there were just like a couple pictures and then a couple adults and so on. And we picked that verse that you read today, "Blow the trumpet in Zion" from Joel.
Cool.
So who is
do you have that in like a PDF form that absolutely you could share with us?
Absolutely, yeah. It's stolen and copied and pasted from resources that you shared with me. We took that for everyone here, as one thing that goes to there. And here, let me see if I can share this actually here with my screen. Maybe not. No, that does not look like. Anyways, but I can maybe share. Yes, I could share probably this. So here you can see the 6-year program that we put together. And then later on, you kind of get a glimpse how we planned our year with the monthly theme, with the scripture references, with possible mission connection to go with, And so these are the topics that will be preached on those 4 or 5 Sundays each month.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, I like
it. I cannot really give it a nutshell. It's kind of like really, we put gifts at the heart of our programming for the year.
Let me ask you a question about that.
Yeah.
What was it like at the leadership level to get to that point? In other words, you described gift has moved from just another program at Eastridge to the heartbeat of what's going on at Eastridge. And there had to be some negotiation with senior pastor and perhaps others in order to bump it up to that level. What was that like?
Well, it took several levels. One was really we went through the different committees. I mean, we had that intergenerational exploration committee that explored the idea and how that could that look like. And then we, in the next step, involved everyone who is in some way involved in faith formation, whether in the children's ministries, in youth ministry, in adult faith formation, all the committees, all the teachers, and had a first presentation there and got first quite puzzled looks. but at the second meeting, we immediately scheduled the second one where we would talk about how that would look like. And then the if was no longer a question at the second meeting, which was interesting from where we left to where we met again. So in between, that kind of sunk in and people embraced that. And once we had the buy-in from the faith formation area, the question was very much, where are we going to place that in our programming? Is this going to be a weeknight? When on a Sunday would be great. Well, should we do that Sunday evening or and so on? And in the same time, we had in our pastoral team conversations going on, and actually it's an older conversation even than this conversation, when we talked about the fact that we never worship together as a congregation. Mm-hmm. And to the point that we have people who've been members for 15 years and who end up in a different worship service at some point and are like, I've never seen you around here, kind of get that response. And so we talked about how can we regularly, quarterly maybe, worship together. And then our senior pastors stepped up a notch and says, let's do that on the monthly basis. And and again, then it was a presentation to the whole session, and then especially also the worship and music committee, with a lot of question marks. Some of them are still here. Some of them are very practical, like what's going to happen with people who show up for the 11 o'clock service who didn't get the memo.
Right.
But, we try to be diligent with any kind of publication that we have out gearing up to this Sunday, that we have to advertise that this is a special Sunday on the second Sunday, with written information, with follow-up phone calls, and on the website and the newspaper and so on, and with moments for mission that we did in worship service over the last 4 weeks. Each week we had a different team of 2 or 3 individuals presenting a different snapshot of what gift can look like and what it's all about.
Oh, I really like what you're describing, and I really like how you have been very deliberate, intentional, and systematic in leading up to the launch of GIFT. And I have little doubt that it will take hold immediately, based on what you've described. And I know that things are stressful now, because this is a big day coming up for you guys on September 11th, but it just seems so clear to me that you have taken all the steps the right way. So, yeah, good
Can
luck.
I just add a thought about, great job. Can I just add a thought about coming up with a logo?
Say that again?
About coming up with the logo. You used Fiverr, is that Fiverr?
FIVERR. Yeah.
Oh, RR. That's right. Yeah. We got a new logo and we used our local arts teacher from the high school to come with it. So that's another idea too. But I've heard about the website you use. That's a good one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Nice. Any other thoughts, comments for Thomas? Thomas, please let us know how it goes on the 11th. I'll be thinking of you. I really will.
Yeah.
And you know, I know that some of what you're doing, you learned first from me a year or so ago in a workshop that I did, and yet now I find myself on the other side. I'm like at St. Charles where I'm now working. I want to do what you're doing. And so I may come to you for consultation. So you better get it right.
Oh, yeah. No pressure.
All right. Thank you. How are you guys doing? I suggest we take a 10-minute stretch and come back, and then the others can bat after that. Sound okay? Yes, he nods yes.
All right. Okay, go ahead. So I sat with, this has kind of been in the making before we even started our classes together. But we've been struggling with the high school youth group model. We tried meeting on Sunday nights, and getting those kids back to church on Sunday nights was just a nightmare. I didn't want to come back to church on a Sunday night either. So after sitting down with Pastor, we decided to move our high school youth group to Wednesday nights, which also includes our adult choir rehearsal and our confirmation program. And what we're going to do is we're going to start out with having the confirmation class and the high school classes meet together to have like a praise and worship time for the first 5 to 10 minutes, and then break off into their separate groups. And as part of the high school youth group, one of the things I'm going to incorporate is once a month is having a caring conversations night, where I'll invite older members of the congregation to come and join us for youth group, and then partner each kid up with a member with a prompt to really sit down and get to know each other, and kind of share one another's faith journey with each other. And that kind of is my way of introducing a mentoring program between the high schoolers and an older generation in the church. And also as part of our confirmation program this year, one of the things that we're going to do, the confirmation students are required to complete 15 worship or sermon notes as part of their requirement. And this year, 5 out of the 15 sermon notes have to be family worship sermon notes, where the kids have to go home with their families and sit down and discuss what they heard, what they saw in worship, and how, as a family, how are they going to apply that in the week ahead. So I'm very excited to start that. And then another thing, we're going to start incorporating family Sunday school once a month.
Yep. I'm sorry, Heather. Sorry to interrupt, but I'm intrigued by this sermon notes idea. So they have 15 questions they have to answer about the sermon? Is that
no? They have to complete 15 forms within the year. So the questions include like what your favorite hymn was, what you saw, heard, or experienced in worship that you can apply to the week ahead, and what were the main points of the sermon.
I see.
Okay. So then on the family form, they're the same questions, but there's like a spot where the kid answers, the parents answer, or guardian, and then a combined answer. And then in like, how would you make yourself a better Christian section? It's all family guided questions how you can apply that to your family the week.
And the implication is that the family was at church also, otherwise they'd have a hard time responding.
Yeah, and that's, I mean, that's one of the things too, is trying to get the families to worship together. This is kind of a way to how one of the changes that I'm thinking is going to fix that problem instead of just dropping your kids off at church and leaving. And so they're really walking through their kids' journey through the confirmation program.
What are you have parents just dropping their kids off and mm-hmm. and they don't go to worship?
Yep.
I'm sure you're the only church in the country that does that.
So then part of the thing too is we're also going to incorporate family Sunday school once a month, where parents will walk through. We have our church used to be a school, so we have several separate classrooms. And the idea is family Sunday school, each classroom will be a different station that the parents will walk with their children through and kind of learn the Bible story that month mm-hmm. or week. And then throughout the year, we also have like curveballs, I guess, that get thrown in. For instance, the weekend of Halloween, we invite families to come as a family, and we are very successful at getting grandparents to come with us too. And we have pumpkin carving, where all the kids carve pumpkins during Sunday school, and we walk them through a pumpkin prayer, where, you know, take the guts, because that's what Jesus does, and takes those bad stuff out of our lives and stuff like that. So it connects the carving of the pumpkin to biblical reference, which is really cute, and the kids like it. So and then also throughout the year, I'm also going to incorporate some more family events, which all again includes grandparents. We are very successful. This is our third year doing a Easter egg hunt. And we like tripled our number. Every year we doubled our numbers. So it's very, you know, the kids come, search for their eggs, claim their prizes. We incorporated a lunch this year. And next year I'm taking it a step further and going to incorporate like a crucifixion story in there as well. So it's a learning experience. And this year also, because families, the feedback from that was so positive, this year we're going to incorporate a winter carnival, where, you know, there'll be different game stations like carnivals, but then also there'll be different, some of the stations will be Bible engaging, and then there'll be one like service one where kids will make cards for our local children's hospital that we can deliver.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, in a nutshell, that's kind of what the programs are. A lot of it is infusing and not necessarily creating anything, but infusing that intergenerational aspect into current programs. As far as the website digital aspect goes, we've been more productive in using Facebook as a form of communication with our members, posting pictures of current events, posting announcements that have been told to me that that's where congregation members are getting their announcements and stuff. They're looking to Facebook. But also our website, I've been there, like I said, it'll be 3 years next month. And our website has been getting done since I've been there. Meaning it's just that empty. So I took it upon myself to start updating our website. I finally got administration rights, started designing it, and really I just started by taking announcements from our bullet or from our weekly newsletter and putting those in the proper categories. Mm-hmm. My next step is going to be we have a Bible on Tap group that meets. So put their monthly study on their page, and slowly but surely making stuff more accessible for the congregation. It's going to be a long process, but that's kind of where I'm going with that.
Oh, Heather, I can relate. I am At my church, I inherited just a crappy website. I mean, it's just terrible. And I shouldn't have said that. This is being recorded. But anyway, I'm doing the same thing, slowly and surely trying to at least provide better stuff there. So. Can I ask another question?
Sure.
Back to your first idea of Caring Conversations Night and how that leads toward, you said you want it to lead toward a mentoring program. What, just describe that a little more.
I would like to see our youth, mainly middle school and high schoolers, partnered up with another a person in the congregation other than their parent that really is there to walk with them through their faith journey. So and be there for them for questions other than, I mean, the kids come to me for their stuff, which is fantastic, but just another person that they can trust in the faith community to go to for guidance. And
Okay, have you done this before? Like, I'm kind of intrigued by Caring Conversation Night, but I worry a little bit that it feels a little contrived.
They have done it in the past, so, and it was received well, and then they just kind of, okay, the person that ran it left the church or whatever the circumstances, and it kind of fell off the radar. And I did find a couple curriculums through, I don't have my notes in front of me, but I found some curriculum that is very positive and will guide these types of programs.
Yeah.
So I'm not kind of running by myself with that.
Yeah, I'd be curious to know the curriculum material that you're using, if you want to share it. That would be terrific.
Yeah, when I figure it out, I will.
Did I interrupt? Was there more that you wanted to report?
Nope, that's pretty much it in a nutshell. It's mainly focusing on family.
Yeah.
Family.
Yeah, well done. Like it. Questions, comments from others for Heather? All right.
Heather?
Yep.
This is Judy. We took our Easter egg hunt to the next level too a couple years ago. And there's some really nice material out there that gives you a whole, like, you buy this book, kind of like Vacation Bible School, but it's just a book that then gives you some things you can do and stuff. And it's been really great because it allows you to do all the religious methods and the little small groups, and the families do it together. And then we end with our Easter egg hunt. Mm-hmm. If I find the material or a link, I'll send it if you're interested, because it took a lot of the work out of our hands. Though we did used to do trunk or treat and tried to blow that up to a fall festival. And after 2 years, we gave that up because it was like, why am I doing trunk or treat and fall festival? And it opened it to the community, but there was no way to throw religion in it without feeling like we were just bait and switch. So I got so much crap the first year, I canceled our trunk or treat. And I wanted to say, well, you know, the number of cars had been declining every year and no one was behind. So it was me trying to run this thing. So we decided to beef up the Easter egg hunt into an Easter event. And that's just been received really well. And you can be religious all over it because it's Easter. So it's an easier way to bring family and faith together than the trunk or treat.
Good. Thank you, Judy. All right. So who wants to go next, Kathy or
Carrie?
I'll
go. I'm good. So my church is doing a lot of reorganization and restructuring and a lot of stuff. So I just decided to stick with two things that already are existing, but how can we transform them into including intentional intergenerational? So the first thing that I'm focusing on is we do a tween group with fourth and fifth graders. It's been one of the most effective things that I've done in my in the ministry at the church. And the tween group meets once or twice a month. So to get this started, we're going to have a meeting in the fall. My plan is to have a meeting in the fall, like November, for a Thanksgiving theme. And the focus will be on caring relationships. So our music director had a conversation with one of our older adults about a person that was at a town hall meeting at our church. And she said, well, I don't know who that is. And the music director was trying to explain to her, well, her daughter's in bells and her daughter's in dance and her daughter sings in the choir. And she had no idea who it was. So our music director has made a point every Sunday to introduce the older adult to one of the kids in the congregation by name so that she knows. So it's been really interesting how that dynamic has happened. A little passive aggressive, but it gets the point across. So this is a great way to just help people to know one another's names, because that's where you have to start. Is if I know your name, I'm more willing or likely to say hi to you than if I'm uncomfortable because I don't know your name or I don't know your face or I'm not familiar with you. So the focus will be on building some relationships, and then everyone will be encouraged to bring an item to be donated to, it's called the Baldwin Center. It's in Pontiac, Michigan, for their Christmas store. Lots of poverty in my area, so it helps to support that. And then have the group work together to do something hands-on, create a card or send something to some of the homebound people from our church. So figuring out what that will look like a little bit more with the older adult person, ministry person. And then the second event will be in the spring and will be more related to faith sharing. So everyone shares a story about how they've seen God working in their life or a faith story from their childhood. Because once you know someone's name, once you start to know their story, you start to care about a person, and it just the snowball continues to go, if you will. So, and have a meal and prayer together and match up the tween group, and we're only talking five or six tweens, with as many older adults as want to participate, and encouraging that prayer back and forth, not just the older adults praying for the kids, but for the children to be intentional about praying for the older adults and to teach that a little bit.
Yeah.
And then possibly next summer having a either an all ages event or at least an intergenerational between the tweens and older adults to go to Cass Community Social Services in Detroit, Michigan to serve there for a day. They're building tiny homes, so it'll be really cool if the kids and the adults can help with that or help serve a meal or something, that they're working together, and that gives them the car ride home to do the car ride there to do some service learning and the car ride home to do some service reflection.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I've been in my setting for 10 years. So the kids that are in fifth grade now were born when I started. So they all know me really well and know each other really well, and we get into a lot of trouble, good trouble, together. So it's a great group that are comfortable with one another to merge them into becoming more intentionally intergenerational.
How do you envision the older adults responding to these ideas?
I think if they are asked specifically, I think it'll be good. We have not done a good job of focusing on older adult ministry. So one of the older adults in our congregation said, hey, let's just have some brainstorming. And 35 people came. So I think that population is hungry to being invested in the life of the church and in the life of the children. They just are looking for an opportunity to do that. So that's where this is one place that we can plug in. That's my phone, sorry. And I talked with her. Was one of her ideas was actually to build this bridge between the tween group and the older adults. So I think it'll be great.
Yeah, yeah, good.
My second idea is with small groups. So one of the prescriptions that my church has to do over the next 2 years is to create intentional small group, diverse small group ministry. And small groups mean something different to every person you ask. So we are looking at how do we do transformational groups that are not curriculum based. So asking questions about how is your life, very Wesleyan, how is your life with God, those kinds of questions. And then having that support in prayer. So we're still working through what that looks like in our setting. It's a really big jump. We have, we're back to no separate Sunday school hour. There's very little adult faith formation. So the small group team decided to do more around formational Bible study, giving people a foundation so that they have the faith language to be comfortable of in sharing their faith in more of the transformational group. So the timeline for this we're calling them connect groups, is January. The goal is to start the small group in January. And ideally we'll include 8 to 10 people that span at least 3 generations. So a family with an older elementary student or youth, at least one person in the young adult range, at least one middle adult, and at least one older adult. The group will meet twice a month at least for life sharing, prayer, a biblically centered devotion, service, and building caring relationships. The group can choose their meeting location and day or time of the week, and the costs will be shared by the group members, so there's not necessarily a cost to the church budget. Mm-hmm. And then each member of the group will have some leader training of the leader, but each member of the group, as time goes by, will be responsible for bringing a biblically centered devotion to each meeting. The goal being everyone in the group grows in their own faith as they prepare for the devotion, gain leadership skills as they lead, and grow more comfortable praying out loud in a group setting. And then the group will choose at least one mission or service project that they'll serve on as a group during the year. So.
Wow. What are the 3 generations again that you envision for these groups?
Well, it'll be at least 3. So older elementary would be kind of the youngest age. So 3rd, 4th, 5th grade.
Okay.
Up through 103.
Yeah, yeah. I really like this idea. I'm wondering about safeguards for child protection in that kind of a setting.
Sure. So the goal would be that it would be a family. So the parent would be involved in the group so that that would take care of that safe sanctuaries type of thing. Mm-hmm.
Okay, great. Yeah. So no child is flying solo in the group.
No.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
With a parent or a grandparent or someone who is related and, yeah.
Oh, I'd really like to hear how this goes. Or I'd like to hear from others if this is something that you have done, if there's particular experiences that you want to share or advice to give to Kathy. Nice. I like it. Did I interrupt, or is there more for you to report to us?
Nope. That's enough.
I agree with that. Well said. That's enough. Thank you, Kathy. Well done. Carrie, would you like to share with us?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Great. Well, nothing new under the sun here. We did launch our Pray For Me campaign. It started, we had the whole month of August to sign up. It went very well. Our goal was to have one prayer champion for each family, no matter how many kids were in the family, because it was the first year. And we ended up having more prayer champions than even children. So we had to couple up, like husband and matched with the same child, and we ended up with 70 matches. So that was very exciting. That's 140 people matched up, and our church is only about 250. So we had really good participation. I still counted about 36 kids that their parents didn't sign them up, and we didn't match them if their parent did not sign them up, because we felt like they needed to give permission for people to have contact with their kids. So, and there are some teenagers that aren't signed up, but it was a pretty good percentage of participation. And it will start September 11th as well. Everybody should have their letters in the mail and have contacted each other by then. And we had like a, just your basic information sheet for them to fill out. What's your favorite food, your favorite color, what sports do you do, what are your hobbies? And then it had some other questions like what's something hard for you, something special about me, what are your plans for the future, what do you like to do in your free time? Because we're going to have parents of infants all the way up through senior high kids filling out this paper, so it had to be fairly generic. And they're supposed to send that and a picture of themselves to their prayer partner by September 11th. And then on October 4th, we're going to have our first get-together, chili supper, and trivia night with intergenerational trivia questions. And we'll have a photo booth at that event as well so they can get a picture together. And then we're going to give them a photo magnet that'll have pray for me on it, and it'll have, they'll be able to put their picture up in their house. And then the inside magnet's gonna have our key verse, which is gonna be Psalm 145:4, which I don't have written down right now, but it's in the back of our book. It's one of the verses that were in the back of our intergenerational. And that book is holding up my iPad right now, so I'm not gonna look it up. And then we are ice cream social after Christmas.
Here it is. Here, Psalm 145:4. One generation shall commend your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts.
That's going to be a key verse for this year. And everybody will have that on their magnet next to their picture. And then that'll be a gift that they get in the mail after the chili supper thing. And I didn't have any problems with people not wanting to buy the book or not wanting to sign up. Some of them said, I don't really understand what we're doing, but I understand that you want me to sign up, and you held a baby on the stage, so I'm signing up because you cried. So the emotional links helped. They understand the importance of it, even if they didn't fully understand what they were doing at the time. And they've received letters since then explaining it in detail. It's on the website. It's on Facebook. So they're getting it. They always understood they were praying, but they keep thinking there's a catch. There's more to it that they have to do. And I keep telling them there's really not. So that went well, I think. I'm excited to see how it goes, how the connections are here. And then the second thing that I worked on is not to happen until maybe the fall of next year, because we've already started this year. Every fall we do a fall fellowship study, and the whole church studies the same thing, but the children have never participated because we are going chronologically through the Bible in a 3-year study. And every time we miss, it means we're missing a section of the Bible that won't be taught. So we're very careful to not do that, but I'm hoping to pull a different time during the week for a family life link, just like Kathy was talking about, where families and all generations get together and have whatever the fall fellowship study is, the groups that are meeting on Sunday, they would do the same thing, but in someone's home. And I would provide material on different levels for those groups so that there would be questions that everybody could answer, but then there would also be space for more adult conversations that are still appropriate for children to hear, but for understanding. Because we all know that our kids go to church. The only kids that don't is 5 and under, and they're invited to go to church, but we do offer a nursery. And we only have one worship service. So our church already worships together every Sunday. Our church, we're not that big. You think we would know each other, but they really don't all know each other's names. And so that's our focus, is trying to get not just to know their name, but to know them personally, about them. And that's our next step. So I think that this family life link would be a good way. And it will also model for the parents how to do devotions with your kids, because I don't think many of them know. And if they can see that it's just a conversation, really. I mean, you don't have to get out science equipment and fake things. And, you know, just it's conversation about the Bible story and what it means to each person in the room. And I think you can do that at any age. So we're going to work on that. And then the last thing is we took all the ideas of the intergenerational learning nights, and we're going to call ours SPAN, Scripture, Prayer, Action, and Nurture. And we're going to plan around those different things. So whatever our focus is will be our scripture. We're going to pray together after we read that scripture or interpret that scripture in some way. We're going to pray in different ways, and we're going to see what the action as Christians we're supposed to do now that we have this knowledge, how it's supposed to change us. And then at the end, after all the learning is over, then we'll have the fellowship meal and have nurture time where they build relationships with each other. And we're going to intentionally change up the seating and make people sit by each other that normally don't, and have those cards on the table for discussion starters. But we haven't chosen what the first topic's going to be yet. So, and we're going to go for the first year, we're going to go for 5th Sundays. There are 5 of them next year, but we'll probably only do 3 of them next year. Get us started. But I had that feeling with the Pray For Me, like I just need to start small so we can get started. And it went really well. We had great turnout. So, who knows? We might end up doing 5 of those. Never know. So,
I like
anything new that anyone else said. And I apologize for missing everybody's. I will go back and watch it.
No problem. I like the acronym of SCAN because it also SPAN. Sorry, SPAN. I wrote SCAN, but I know it means Scripture, Pray, Act, Nurture. I like it because it also kind of gives a pedagogy of it actually tells people what we're going to do and even the order in which we're going to do it. So that's nice. I am impressed with the big response you got to the prayer champions idea. And remind me, Carrie, is that a program or a little piece of curriculum that you inherited, but you found somewhere that you're doing? Yeah.
It's a program. It's a website online, and they have all the clip art and all the handouts and everything. We ended up not using most of their forms. But we just, but we got what we needed from it. The only warning I would give is it only goes for 13 weeks, so they tell you to pray for a year. So we told the church we're going to go through the book the first 13 weeks together. And then after that, they can either repeat the book or they can pray scripture. And we'll, there's tons of scripture to pray over people. Blessings, they can do prayer journals, they can do personal prayers. So we're hoping that we actually have quite a few people in our church that aren't comfortable praying and don't really understand how to pray. We have a lot of people from
really, really. I find that amazing.
Yeah, we have a lot
You're probably the only church that has people like that.
Well, this is not meant to be offensive in any way, but we have a lot of people that come from the Catholic background that only know memorized prayers.
Really?
Random, like on the spot. They're not comfortable praying for each
people.
And so that's really odd to us, where we don't know the memorized prayers. And so trying to give them both kinds of things to do, and this book will help them. We're all doing the same prayer, just like at Catholic church, where everyone's saying the same prayer, but it also teaches them how to pray for someone. And so then when they're on their own, they'll be able to start, we hope, being able to pray more comfortably on their own.
Sure. Yeah. Beautiful. Good work, Carrie, especially with all those Catholics.
Like I said, no offense. I did teach at Catholic school for 3 years, and I have a lot to hear about it. So, yeah.
Good, good. Any comments or questions for Carrie?
Carrie, can you remind me what church you're with?
Memorial Baptist Church in Jefferson City.
Yeah. Good.
You're welcome to look at that Pray For Me stuff on the website. It's www.memorialchurch.net. Oh, and I have another exciting thing. From our last class, when we did all the website stuff, I started a blog, and I thought nobody was reading it. But when I went today to put the next blog on, all of them have like 30 or 40 visitors to each time I posted. So
is that right?
About that. It's not a waste of time.
That's terrific. Yeah, that's good. Oh, you guys, I'm just so impressed and inspired by all the things that you've shared today, and the plans that you've built, and I know that each of you will implement them too. I mean, you're not, oh boy, I don't want to say something I shouldn't say. We've all met people who dream up plans and they never come true. But I know that you guys are not those people. So, John, I'm wondering, you've sat and listened, any thoughts, global for us on what you've heard today?
Yeah, I really loved listening to all the different projects and the rest. I think just a little bit of looking ahead, when you get to the family course, you're gonna see a lot of affirmation for the things that you've already started doing, and then a way to expand it and deepen it. So this was helpful for me to listen to all of it with the family faith formation course coming up next. So I think you'll be able to continue to build on what you have, not start all over again. So it'll be developmental in that sense. Yeah.
Yeah. Good. Well, listen, I wanted to kind of conclude our time together by sharing. I had in mind two things that I wanted to share with you. The first one, I don't really need to do, but I'll tell you what it was anyway. Only for your sake, for reference, I guess, is I thought I would want to take you back to one of the discussion questions that we had this week, or not this week, but in our course. My course sites page is moving slowly because I just found. I found your input on developing 10 effective practices in intergenerational faith formation so helpful and so so creative. I guess I just wanted to point it out to you. And if you're looking for ideas, your classmates have each generated 10 that are terrific. Just so you know how I got there, I went to discussions and then down to the item that said develop 10 effective practices. But the stuff that you guys have shared today is also really rich and much more developed than these lists. So anyway, that's there. The other thing that I wanted to share with you is some information on slides. Are you seeing my slides?
Yes.
Okay. In my experience, over the last 10 years at least, in working with churches in developing, admittedly, intergenerational programming, that's primarily learning programming, as opposed to creating that intergenerational culture, that's a whole next step. But I've identified 10 or 12 items. So what really makes it sing? What makes it work? And I think this is helpful in, toward moving toward that culture of intergenerationality as well. So maybe it's my own need to have the last word or whatever, but I just thought these might be helpful conclusions to the course. So churches have said to us, when you're doing intergenerational programming, have variety. Keep the learning interesting and informative. Don't always do it the same way, the same format, etc. Timing. Inside an intergenerational program, particularly a gathered event, pay attention to the ebb and flow of energy. Know your plan well, but be flexible in that. If a particular activity is lagging, then scrap it. If another activity is really engaging people, then allow it to go overtime. Always, always, always work with a team in terms of the planning and implementation and evaluation. If you're flying solo and trying to do intergenerational programming, it will kill you. It's a recipe for burnout. Plus, And I'd say that the burnout comes first, not in terms of physical energy, but in terms of the creative energy that you would bring to the programming. So often I sit with teams. In fact, just earlier this week, I was working with Zora Lutheran Church in Canby, just south of Portland here. And the things that they think up in their meetings as a team would just be impossible for any one person to think up. Be open to the movement of the spirit. But I always say good planning and knowing your plan allows you to be flexible in the way it becomes implemented. Hospitality, of course, is crucial. That goes without saying. Understanding what the learning objectives are, or maybe a better word is, what are the growth objectives, and have them clearly articulated and form your plan around those. I have worked with lots of groups who are really good, for example, at doing community building and icebreakers, but not always good at connecting those to the theme or the topic or the learning that's supposed to take place. And when you do that too often, people realize, you know, this thing isn't as well organized as it ought to be, and they lose interest. Good facilitation. You want people who are working with groups who can really take care of everyone. That sense of, one of the dynamics that I experience in an intergenerational program is practically no matter what you're doing, there's some people who are less interested in that particular activity than others. But if you're a good facilitator or a good MC, then you're communicating a sense of, don't worry, I'm taking care of you and we're going to be moving to something different momentarily. And we keep things moving, and everybody gets taken care of. A strong understanding of who our audience is, who are the people in front of us. We need to know them well, and we need to learn what resonates with them. Sometimes we end up developing programming for a phantom audience of the people we would like to see in front of us, when in fact that might be different from the actual people we have in front of us. And of course, it has to be engaging. There has to be the expectation that everybody participates. One of the most effective downers of an intergenerational gathering is when some people, and it's never children, it's always the big people, who want to simply observe from the sidelines. And that really sends a message that is contrary to the whole process. So we engage everyone in it. The work that we do, whether it's head learning, whether it's heart exploration, whether it's spirituality, or whether it's service, it all the meaningfulness of it has to be explicit. And I always say to groups who are doing intergenerational learning, don't be afraid of the content, of sharing good chunks of Christian content, church teaching, whatever, with groups, because without that, they soon begin to feel as though their time isn't well spent. Yes, community building is important. Yes, relationship building is important. But over time, we want to give them some meat to chew on in the context of relationship building. And so we use good resources. We want to start with good material, but everybody needs to adapt. And I think most of you know that we've developed some intergenerational programming stuff at Vibrant Faith. And you're certainly aware of other resources, but almost never is it simple plug and play. There's always grab it, adapt it, and then implement that. Some churches have more and more useful facilities than others for intergenerational gathering. We've worked with, over the years, churches where their only space that they can gather people is in their sanctuary, and with pews in the way, and et cetera. But we've seen a lot of creativity in that regard. So paying attention to your space is crucial, but just about any space can be, the challenges of the space can be overcome with creativity. Prayer is always a part of these gatherings. It's not just an add-on, though. It's integrated, and there's lots of creative ways to integrate prayer into the experience. I've learned that the lead pastor in your congregation is crucial toward success. It's a little bit what Thomas was sharing with us about how gift is not just an added program at East Ridge Presbyterian, but it's become the centerpiece, the cornerstone, the driver, if you will, of faith formation. And lead pastor and parish staff and the session, which is like your pastoral council, all are crucial in order to move it to that level. So how do you know you're succeeding? I put together this slide or two about a year or so ago when we were talking. I was talking with a group of practitioners, and they just simply began to describe some of the things that they've observed when they're doing intergenerational faith formation well. People experience genuine belonging. And this is a quote from someone on the evaluation. It was significant to be known. I know that I belonged. I knew my life mattered to others. People experience support. It gave me a family in which healing acceptance was found. They experience wealth. Both young and old have resources to share. And this isn't just, I'm not really referring to financial wealth, but human wealth. Character, humility, mutual submission, and respect emerge as we teach and model each other. In children, we can begin to see the opportunity for a deep personal relationship with as many people of God as possible. In teenagers, an opportunity to find examples and mentors among the emerging adults and older adults in our community. In the young adults, opportunities to have their stories heard and their search for identity validated as they journey toward God and adulthood. And in adults, encouragement, support, spiritual application in the midst of angst and struggle. And lastly, in the elders, an opportunity to be revered as elder and to bless children and teens with unconditional love and acceptance. So if I had to paint a portrait of intergenerationality in my parish, it would be an ideal portrait. It's like we're not there yet, but these are the things I would paint the portrait of. So, so I have a video that I wanted to share with you to kind of close us out. But before I do that, I welcome thoughts, comments. All right. I'm going to trust that you can hear the video. Well, it's a song. You've heard the song "Morning Is Broken," and just a quick introduction. One of the churches I've worked with over the past 3 years. This was their year-end photo collage, if you will, that culminates their year-end celebration of the intergenerational programming learning that they had done for the year. It's not this year, but last year, I believe. So enjoy. Oops, sorry. I moved right out of it. I pressed the wrong button. It's coming, don't worry. Now I go here. I get rid of that. Share screen. Here we go.
Like the first morning, that bird has spoken, like the first bird. for the singing, praise for the praise for them springing, fresh from the garden. Sweet the rains move on, summer from heaven, like the first dewfall on the earth. Praise for the sweetness of the love, sprung in completeness.
All right, you guys, thank you. Thank you for chiming in today. I think that's it. I don't have anything else.
See you on September
12th.
14th.
Yes.
For live presentation one on family. So mark your calendars.
I've got a quick question for John and Leif, if you wouldn't mind.
Sure.
Okay. Our synod in the Northwest Synod of Wisconsin, we have a large, we have a large learning event once a year. It's called Walking Together. And we meet at one of the local universities, UW-Wisconsin-Eau Claire. And we have maybe 30 different programs that people can go to, seminars they can go to, about 45 minutes, an hour long. And they have 5 options throughout the day. So they mingle and go through out the building. And the idea came across, they were interested in looking for someone to come talk about intergenerational learning and faith formation. And so I just mentioned they knew I was going to taking this class. So they asked me if I could ask you all, but here's the caveat, we have no money. So I don't know if you had anyone close by that might be able to help us, or if this is even feasible.
I could certainly do some homework for you.
Okay.
And somebody maybe in the Twin Cities or Milwaukee where it's close, they're doing intergenerational. Sure.
Right. Yeah. Now, Minneapolis would be really close. That's only about an hour away. And Milwaukee would be a little farther away for them, but I can get you some more information. We're just at the beginning of planning for that. And so they asked me to ask the two of you about that. So, okay.
Mary,
we do
send me an email with the info.
Okay. I'll do that. Great. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
See you all later.
Have a great weekend, everybody.
All right. Thanks, you all. Bye-bye.
Great job.
Bye.